One of the biggest questions regarding the bombardment of Earth by asteroids or comets is if it's just a more or less random chance event, where an asteroid happens to hit us, or if it's actually non-random and is caused by something in the outer solar system perturbing comets and sending hails of them into the inner solar system periodically. There are actually two ways this can happen, and both are equally spooky. The first is if there is a large body in the outer solar system that periodically deflects comets our way. There have been a number of incarnations of this idea, going back to the 1980s with the concept of an actual second star termed Nemesis, which would have been a dim, tiny red dwarf orbiting the sun at great distance. At the time, this was invoked to explain an apparent periodicity to asteroid impact-related mass extinctions. It turns out, it's probably not the case, and most mass extinctions on Earth were not due to asteroids or comets, but other causes, though the one that killed the dinosaurs certainly was. But that didn't kill the idea completely. More recent work has found what might be a loose correlation in the ages of known impact craters on Earth that could suggest that something in the outer solar system is perturbing objects and sending them our way on a periodic basis. And indeed, at least two potential planets are hypothesized to potentially exist in the outer solar system. One of these is the infamous Planet 9 hypothesis, which may explain odd orbital inclinations of objects in the outer solar system. And the other is the lesser-known Planet 10 hypothesis, where a Mars-sized object is advanced to be the cause of the so-called Kuiper Cliff feature, where a very well-defined line seems to exist in the Kuiper Belt that may suggest that a planet is shepherding its edge. Whether either of those could perturb comets periodically is unknown, but there is another option. It's past stellar encounters. 70,000 years ago, a star known as Schultz's star passed within our Oort cloud. It's entirely possible, and recent research actually bolsters this possibility, that the stellar encounter perturbed a hail of comets and they're heading this way. That could be bad news for Earth, but the good news is that it's going to take roughly 2 million years for them to get here. Plenty of time for them to be discovered and deflected if any prove to be dangerous. But this is all very hard to prove. We know that comet material composed of ice and rock, as opposed to iron and stone like asteroids, do periodically enter Earth's atmosphere. Several events have recently happened that might have been cometary material, the most famous being the Tunguska blast of 1908. That seems to hint that the objects involved weren't particularly sturdy and may have been composed of a large component of ice. This would make them very likely to be of cometary material, and as our periodic meteor showers on Earth, like the Perseids, each year show, comet material does get deposited in the inner solar system when comets pass through, suggesting that at least some perturbation occurs in the outer solar system all the time, with or without a planet or passing star being involved. But mundane explanations like more planets existing within the star system that we currently know of, there are some more exotic possibilities for an object to perturb material from the outer solar system and send it inward. Questions can be asked about passing black holes, for example, which a small enough one might act as a perturber. Or how about a passing brown dwarf not bound to the sun? These are unknowns. But there's actually an even crazier one, and it's recently been advanced that it may have actually been the one that ended the reign of the dinosaurs. It's dark matter, one of the most mysterious materials in the universe. Here it pays to revisit just what dark matter is and why scientists think it exists. The core problem that gives rise to the notion of dark matter is that most galaxies don't behave as they should. When you calculate the gravity needed to hold them together, it doesn't mesh with the amount of matter contained in those galaxies, not by a long shot. By all rights, there are galaxies in the universe that should be flying apart, but they're not. So either our understanding of gravity at very large scales is wrong, which observation doesn't seem to indicate, or there is some form of otherwise undetectable invisible matter contributing to the overall gravity of these galaxies. In fact, most of the matter in the universe, must be of this invisible variety. And that's why most astronomers think that dark matter must exist. But the opposite argument can be made. Dark matter is not something we've detected in nature before. So how much of a stretch is it to invoke something that has never actually been observed? Well, the reality is that something like it has. It's the neutrino, and while neutrinos alone do not account for dark matter, they are weakly interacting particles that pass through most matter undetected. Only occasionally does an interaction happen, so it could be said that neutrinos are actually a form of dark matter. But experiments looking directly for dark matter as an unknown weakly interacting particle, perhaps like a neutrino, have so far turned up nothing. But most scientists still agree that dark matter must be there, or the universe wouldn't work as it does. Same with the concept of dark energy. The universe just doesn't work as observed without invoking it. But science is a learning process, and subject to constant revision. So it's also possible that some model will be found that explains these observed effects, and overturns the apple cart. But say for a moment dark matter is real. Can it affect us in catastrophic ways? Well, it may have in the form of the Cretaceous-Paleogene extinction event that killed the classical dinosaurs about 66 million years ago, and left only the birds as their descendants. In a paper by Lisa Randall and Matthew Reece from 2016, link in the description below, they detailed that dark matter could also be a perturber of comets, and may have done so with the object that struck Earth and ended the dinosaur age. And it actually meshes well with the apparent periodicity of impact events on Earth, though the evidence for this is weak and has been disputed periodically. The idea is this. The Sun follows the swirling of the Milky Way's spiral arms, which incidentally involves dark matter. But the Sun also moves independently and bobs up and down in relation to the galactic plane. It's possible that the galaxy's dark matter gets denser in regions with denser matter concentrations. So as the Sun bobs up and down through this concentration of dark matter, the effect could be that comets get perturbed by the gravity of the dark matter, sending periodic hails of comets into the inner solar system. This would correspond to a period of about 35 million years, and that's exactly what the correlations of impact cratering events seem to suggest. But there's a problem. Dark matter isn't thought to be capable of settling into such concentrations. It's very weakly interacting, so the equation for concentrating changes. But that assumes that all dark matter behaves the same. That is an unknown. We have no idea if there are classes of dark matter or situations where it can behave differently than what is currently thought. Some measurements of the galactic center show that maybe dark matter does behave differently in certain situations, and modeling shows that it may be possible for such a disk of material to exist in the galaxy and explain the correlations with mass extinctions, if those correlations do indeed exist. But there are problems. One is that we don't really know what the nature of the impactor that killed the dinosaurs was. If it was Oort cloud material, it would have been rock and ice. But if it was an asteroid, it would be more like rock and iron. The iridium-rich layer that was laid down during the extinction event from material from the impactor tends to point into the direction of an asteroid, but only very weakly so. Other evidence points to cometary material. But if it was a near-Earth asteroid rather than a proper comet, then a near-Earth origin is more likely. If it were a comet, however, which is backed up by isotopic evidence, then some kind of perturbation may have been involved in the periodicity. The question remains about just what the nature of the perturber is, but it's an interesting thought nonetheless, in that it may be something entirely out of our current paradigm of thinking. It's entirely possible that there are things going on in the universe of which we currently have no conception and could cause our extinction. It wasn't very long ago that the very idea of dark matter would have been rejected outright by scientific consensus. Most of the universe's matter is invisible and can pass through walls? Doesn't seem plausible. Yet the need for invoking it arose because observation suggests that it must exist. And recent work has also suggested that the universe could go through a dramatic alteration if it were to tunnel to a lower energy state, if it's not already there. in which case a bubble of changed universe would expand out at the speed of light. And once it overtook us, it would cause not only our extinction, but an alteration of how matter itself can exist in the universe, if it could still exist at all. Dark matter having a hand in killing the dinosaurs doesn't seem so far-fetched in light of that. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently worried about the asteroid impact. What if we never saw it coming, and then it suddenly happened, and all the talking parrots, ravens, and other dinosaurs still living on this planet collectively looked at us and all said, "Not again." And the last lesson of existence we get is that the birds were smarter than we thought they were, and they just didn't have much to say until the impact hit. I wonder if they'd make it through again. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.